We're at Shane Park. We sitting here backstage with the one and only Lynn Roundtree.
What's happening? How you feeling?
I'm feeling great. I missed your show in Grand Rapids.
Yeah.
I was in Grand Rapids for a while, and then I had to leave. I found out that you were in Grand Rapids through their promos in Grand Rapids.
Oh, man.
The Mayweathers was planning on coming to check you out.
Yeah.
I don't know if they did it. I haven't got back with them.
Yeah.
But I told them if they do, to walk up to you and say, T. Pablo.
Okay.
And everything would have been cool.
Okay. Yeah.
So now that you're back in Detroit, how you feel?
I'm good. I feel real good. I'm thankful for being able to come back home. Actually down the street from where I first had my first show was at the Key Club a decade ago, and to be right down the street at Shane Park, a place I dreamed about playing, is truly a blessing.
I know it is. You got a packed house. It's not too often that the prodigal son or the prodigal daughter comes home. They've been so much on the road, and a lot of times, because you grew up with a lot of people out here, they just don't act like you're a superstar.
Yeah, it's that hometown thing that a lot of artists talk about. In fact, I was having a conversation with Jessica about it in your hometown, because you grow up there.
Yeah.
You grow up. I'm not actually from Detroit, but I've been here for a couple decades. So musically, I'm saying I've grown up here, moved on to 7 Mile and Braille, lived there for 6-7 years. So yeah, I'm a Detroiter. I started my musical journey here in Detroit. So this is where I say I'm from. So you know, you do the Key Club, you do Floods, you do, you know, some of the places you're doing everybody's party, you're doing weddings. Everybody knows you from the circuit, and it's not often that we break out of the circuit as musicians. There's a lot of musicians are stuck in this. They know, it's not that they want to stay there, but they just can't put it together right to get out of the circuit and move on. Through the grace of God, through hard work, through a lot of my team members, a lot of the musicians in my family, I've been able to do that. And I've been able to get out and spread my music all over the world, and then finally come full circle back to here, back to Detroit, to where people start to acknowledge what I'm doing and where I've gone and where I've been.
It must be a well-kept secret, because as you know, a lot of musicians, including yours truly, we try so hard, but out of 100, even 200 musicians, one or two is going to crack that code and go to the next level.
And I'm telling you, it's a code. And every level, there's another code.
Right.
They throw out codes, and then you reach corners, you turn lands, reach corners, you get to a door, and oh, yeah, here it is. Oh, you open the door, there's another door. Then you go through another door, and it's a trap door. You fall through down to another level. And so you got to turn around, come back up. You got to pick yourself up. You have to persevere.
So you're constantly paying your dues.
You're constantly paying your dues to the next level. So, you know, you're at this level. And if you become complacent, that's when your music suffers. That's when you suffer. If you think you've made it, that's when you stop caring and being humble to the music. And just remembering what it took to get there gives you the energy and fuel to keep going forward. So that's what I use. I use, hey, look, I was playing in Floods in Detroit. But I always say this, if you're able to make people smile and make people dance at Floods, or make people smile and dance anywhere in the city of Detroit, you know, they hard crowd. You know, they liable to pick your horn up and throw it out the window if you can't play. And then I'm coming up in some of them Baker's Keyboard Lounge with some of the legends, learning, getting on the stage, getting waxed off the stage from people. But yeah, you know, Detroit is a music city, and they know their music. And if you're able to be successful, actually, the name Detroit precedes you. So they can say, Lynn Rush. Is it Lynn who? From Detroit. Oh, okay. It goes
cool.
Okay to, yeah, he's cool too. Oh, now I better play. Because they said I'm from Detroit, I should be able to play. So
right.
Yeah, it's a humbling experience.
How long have you been playing the trumpet?
I've been playing the trumpet since the fifth grade. I use it as a time to kind of get out of class. And also, my dad played a Jedi mind trick on me. You know, he's Master Jedi, and he had a trumpet that he had played in college that he had stopped playing, but he put the trumpet on my mantelpiece of our front room. And the mantelpiece was the only place I couldn't touch. That trumpet was the only thing I couldn't touch in the entire room. And so he said, yeah, you can't touch that. You can touch anything else in here. You can even sit on the white couch. You can't touch that trumpet. So, of course, one thing I did touch was the trumpet. And he set it up, he put a little pin on it, and realized I had moved it, and said, well, now you got to play it. And so that's when I started playing. And fortunately, when I ended up graduating and going to college, the first thing he gave me was that trumpet. Because he said, this will remind you, you know, why you started, why you played it. You know, it reminds you it takes discipline. And you got to listen. You didn't listen, but you stuck with it and you were successful. I have that trumpet to this day on my mantelpiece.
Wow. Now that song,
Pass the Groove.
We said in the groove, but it's past. That's past our jam.
Yeah, thank you, man.
Yeah, it plays often on Detroit High Radio.
Thank you, man.
When you went into it, most of the people knew it too, because they were like,
Well, it's got a groove. Even if you don't know it, you know, it's got a groove that make you bounce. That's why I put it in the front of the set, because I have some other stuff in the back. I had a problem trying to figure out where to, because that's my new song. That's my new single.
Yeah.
After six CDs, you start to have a lot of songs to perform on the set, and you kind of go through what songs sound good with what, and I already had the heavy hitting songs at the back, and so I tried to put that song in the back. It kind of got lost in the sauce after Amplified and You Rock My World, dedication to Michael Jackson's birthday today. So I said, well, let me highlight that and put it at the front, and that will get people's juices flowing, and people will get into it, and it works.
That song by Michael Jackson, that groove, hot. How can we get our hands on that?
That song is on my third project, Soul Tree, the Soul Jazz Experience. It's online. You can grab it on iTunes. You can get it on Amazon. You can download it on any medium that has my music. Spotify. Google me. Lynn Roundtree, Michael Jackson, and You Rock My World comes right up.
Okay.
And to be associated with Michael Jackson, I was so scared. That was the last song I actually did on that album. I had said, okay, I want to do it with Michael Jackson because he had just passed away. You know, I was just nervous. I was scared to do it. And one of my boys heard it and they started grooving. He's like, man, what is this? Who is this? I was like, that's me. He was like, man, you ain't putting that on the album. I was like, I'm scared. He was like, nah, man, put that on the album. Put that on the album. I was like, okay, all right, I put on. And so now it's a fan favorite, and I close the show with it. And then go into Heartbreak Hotel, because it's the same key, it's got the same groove, and the guitar player's playing, and we take it right out then.
Do you got a new project, or you resting on this latest CD?
Stronger Still is my new project. It just came out
just
in February.
Okay.
So we're still riding on, we've got a single out called Take It Back, featuring a guitarist out of L.A. named Adam Holly. We've got that spinning. We might pop another couple songs off of it. We did a soft release of Something More to R&B Radio. A lot of people picked it up. A lot of people started playing it. A lot of people enjoy what myself and Jessica Jolia did, who was my special guest for tonight, from all the way from L.A. And so we did a soft release on that. But we're also probably going to release a couple more singles. But I'm still working with, you know, other people. I'm recording with them. We just did a song with Mike Manson, bass player out of Chicago. That song they just put to radio. I just had a successful song with another bass player named Julian Vaughn. That song, you know, went up to number 3 on the National Billboard chart. So we do a lot of collaborating amongst ourselves. I play with other people. I produce for other people. I produce for Althea Renee and other people. I produce one of her hits. And so, yeah.
Althea Renee, that's my girl.
Yeah,
I play percussion for her.
Do you? Okay.
I used to. A couple of times.
I've written a couple songs where she's on 3 of my CDs, and I'm on a couple of hers.
That's great.
Homegirl.
I got another question about your live performances.
Mm-hmm.
You're exciting on the stage. You have a visual that's out of sight.
Thank you. Really enjoy it. Appreciate it.
Who were your inspirations to do that? The only person I could think that comes close, he wasn't that animated, but he was animated just by the way he looked, and that was Miles Davis.
When
he went out to the funk thing on the corner.
Yep.
Remember that album? On the corner.
Yeah, well, I mean, Miles, he started all this electronic music anyway, because nobody was playing electronic keyboards, electric bass, and all that stuff in that type of band anywhere. When he came out with Bitches Brew, that kind of changed music. Yeah. And so people are like, whoa, what is that? So people don't even realize Miles was a trendsetter in music. He changed it a couple times, even with his his West Coast, you know, cool music. He started that whole cool music movement.
And he inspired that space age look with the big glasses.
With the big glasses, and especially he didn't like to be confined to a microphone. He hated being behind a microphone. So he created the whole wireless microphone walking around with the trumpet.
Oh.
So trumpet players weren't doing that before Miles. So now, you know, I don't want to be behind a microphone playing upright. I want to be able to move around. You know, Miles did inspire a lot of that.
We know you've been working hard. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been talking to Lynn Roundtree. He's one of the hottest trumpeters on the smooth jazz scene. What do they call your music? Is it smooth jazz? Is it funky jazz? What is it?
It's whatever makes you feel good. You know, a lot of smooth jazz artists aren't very fond of the term smooth jazz.
Okay.
Because if you come see us live,
that's
anything but smooth. You know what we did with the rock guitar and all that.
It's funky,
but you can't say funky jazz.
Right.
You know, people are trying to go soul jazz, but everybody's like, I don't know what that is. And, you know, so we kind of get locked into the genre because that name, you know, precedes us. My music, I would call it instrumental R&B.
We had that conversation, and I was saying, well, it ain't contemporary jazz. It ain't straight ahead jazz. It ain't smooth jazz.
It's not
really
fusion.
Well, you might as well just put Stevie Wonder up there and put Lynn Rowntree up there, you got the same thing.
Exactly. So, I mean, if you remove, if you replace, you can put vocals in most of my music.
Yeah.
And it'd be an R&B song.
Yeah.
I've got a couple songs that are, you know, jazzy, some fusion stuff that I do. But for the most part, I'm R&B at heart. You know, I'm R&B. You know, I grew up listening to R&B. I grew up listening to hip-hop. You know, I was there with the hip-hop movement with the Adidas suits and the, and Run DMC. I was right there with all of that. So, you know, I wasn't a jazz guy, per se, and I didn't get into jazz until, you know, I got into deep into college. And
what I like about what you're doing is that you took the music by the horns, meaning a lot of artists try to play Coltrane and Miles. That was their day.
Mm-hmm.
Where you coming from today?
Yeah.
See, where you coming from is where you coming from today. Even though you're doing riffs, you know, you're doing your runs, same stuff, but you got a different beat on it.
And you have to create. Well, first you got to look back, and you have to look back. You have to understand what made Bed up for us, you know, what the foundation is. And
you got to look back.
So I listen to all of my trumpet players, Lee Morgan, Trax Navarro, Clifford Brown, Freddie Hubbard, some of the newer guys, Roy Hargrove. I love all of these guys. Booker Little. I can go down the list. I've got Woody Shaw is my guy, man. A lot of people can't get into Woody Shaw, but I love Woody. He was heady. He played different. I like people who play different, you know, and no one could really get what Woody did. But at the same time, I listen to that, and I try to develop my own sound.
And you got
I try to develop my own sound. Yeah. I don't want to sound like this person or that person or this person, and I'm still searching for a sound. I'm still searching for the perfect melody, the perfect solo. You know, I'm trying to play. You know, tonight it was a little rough because I couldn't hear a lot of stuff, so I didn't know what I was playing. Some, and then I kind of blew my lip a little bit. But you know, at that same, you can't worry about that. You got to keep going.
I heard that Shane Park's sound system frustrates a lot of musicians.
It's frustrating, but you know, look, all things considered, if it's frustrating to everybody, everyone has to deal with it. And the fans and people don't know.
No, they don't.
They don't know. No, they want to enjoy you, so you can't stand up there, you know, stomping your heels and being mad.
Yeah.
You got to go.
Show must go on.
Show must go on. And the second I walked out there, I couldn't hear anything. But I'm like, look, if I got to smile and twirl and do my thing, and that's what repetition that comes with doing a lot of shows. I know where I am in the show. I know, you know, what the cats know what they're supposed to be doing. And you know, we know at the end of the day, if we got that groove going, it doesn't matter what the sound, what's going on with the sound people, you know, as long as you can hear that beat and that groove, people are going to move with you. So, you know, the response, I gauged on the response, and the response, I felt it coming back to me when we finished. I felt the love. So, and I just thank everybody for supporting Lynn Rowntree. I thank everybody for supporting the music. Yeah, I thank everybody for Detroit Hot Radio for providing us a platform in which to play, in which to get our music heard, because you guys are the most important to us.
Wow.
People like you, Detroit Hot Radio, and outfits like yours that, you know, enjoy and love the music and expose your listening audience to different people. If it wasn't for you, you know, we would be nothing. So thank you for everything you guys do for me and for the music.
Yeah. Just note, I'm on there
24/7. We also got Andrea LB, our social media vice VP of social media.
Yep. And she does a great job. You know, I appreciate, and then, you know, social media is so important nowadays.
Yes.
It's so important. People, promoters actually look to see how many, you know, followers you have. You know, we're going to book him based on the followers he has.
Wow.
You know, and based on the response. If he puts out a video or something, you know, what's the response? And so that's why you see me. I do a lot of promos for a lot of the shows. So promoters like it. And promoters say
they're one of the few
they see
that promotes.
Rowntree's doing it. And it's nothing. I'm Lynn Rowntree.
New artist.
Yeah.
Trying to get to where you are and do all what you're doing.
Right.
That's, I tell them all the time, it's social media.
Social media. You got to have a good social media presence. You have to, and you know what? I used to fight the whole Facebook Live thing. And, because, you know, when you listen.
Say hey.
You won't say, I love Facebook
Live.
Hey. I'm talking about when I'm playing, because sometimes it's like cell phone videos don't capture the essence of the trumpet. It sounds whiny. But I'm like, you know what? You have to embrace it. You have to embrace the new technology. You have to just say, okay, well, I'm going to go with it. Facebook Live, videos, everybody's got a cell phone, everybody's listening. That's fine. Let's embrace it. Let's not fight it.
No.
You know, let's not.
And we can use it to our advantage.
Yeah, you can use it to our advantage.
Yeah.
Use it to your advantage. And the thing is, now I look back, you all, Facebook Live, you see, when I go home, I'll start to look at my news feed, and I'll start to see everybody posted something. Whether it sounds good or if it doesn't sound that great to me, nothing ever sounds good to me. I don't think anything ever sounds good. So I'm like, oh, man. But I've had to learn to embrace. People are excited. And when they post you, embrace it. They love. If I'm willing to post somebody, that means I care about them. You know what I mean? It gives you a warm feeling. Like somebody's taking their time to post me because they're excited. As long as you want to post me, I'm good.
I'm very excited.
And then it shows the excitement of the people.
We tried to get somewhere. Weren't you in Flint?
I was in Flint. I was Flint and Grand Rapids.
And we didn't get up there. Yeah. He ended up having to do something else. Yeah. And I'm like, oh, man. I really wanted to go out. I had my stuff already packed and ready to go.
You know what? That show was, it was a good show, but it got rained out. I mean, that's another thing. Things happen in shows. Rain, technical issue. There were probably about 150 people out there after it rained because, you know, some people are afraid of the rain. Some young ladies are afraid of getting their hair wet. You know, so we took that into consideration, but we played our hearts out, and we even played even more so because the few people that were there were diehards, and we said we're going to give you what we would give you if this place was packed, if this place had thousands of people out here. So we've played thousands of people. I've played a couple people, and I try to make everybody feel like they're part of my show, part of what I'm doing, and just try to play my butt off for everybody.
So if one person came to see you, you gonna give him a show because he took his time out.
Her time. They took their time out to come see me. They got in their car. They paid whatever money. They got this. It takes time for somebody to do something. You know how many times you're sitting around the house? Man, I don't feel like going. Just the act of getting up, going somewhere, you know, just tells me, hey, look, I'm going to give you my all. And that's what I tell all artists to do.
Well, you got a lot of fans coming in.
These are my people. This is my family. These are all my family. Yeah. So they're indentured fans.
Okay. Artists here too, so we're gonna see if we can catch up with
Rochelle. Yeah.
It was so great talking to you. You know, we support you 100%, and we appreciate this interview. It's gonna make us look good.
Detroit Hot Radio, man. DetroitHotRadio.com. I love you guys. Thank you so much, man.
Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Much love to you.
Much love.
Much love to you.